producing countries. Together, these two countries, Ivory Coast and Ghana, they will be contributing to about 50% of the world's cocoa cultivation. And currently, 40 to 50 million people depend upon cocoa for their livelihood. And the total production of cocoa is 3.97 million tons, in which African countries, they will be contributing to about 71%, America 14%, Asia and Oceania about 14%. In the Asian continent, Indonesia and Malaysia are the leading producers of cocoa. And the Indian scenario of cocoa. Cocoa was introduced way back in 1798 in Tirunelveli district of the old Madras state. And cocoa cultivation was then widely taken up in the Western Ghats region, mainly in the rubber and coffee growing regions of Malabar and Mysore states, because these regions, they receive high rainfall and dry spells will be very lesser in these regions. And the cocoa is commercially being cultivated as plantation crop from 1970 onwards. So cocoa is mainly grown in states of Kerala, Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh and Tamil Nadu states. And the total area under cocoa cultivation in India is 78,000 hectares and the production is 16,050 million tons as per DCCD data. And coming to the area of cocoa, Tamil Nadu ranks first and Andhra Pradesh ranks first in production. And the highest productivity is observed in Kerala, which is 785 kg per hectare. And the average productivity of cocoa in India is 475 kg per hectare. See how variation is there when comparing the productivity of cocoa in India and productivity in Kerala. So the double the difference in productivity can be increased. And the demand for cocoa beans in Indian chocolate industry and confectionaries is portrayed as 30,000 million tons by DCCD. This is about the area, production and productivity of cocoa in India. And coming to the export potential, cocoa is an export-oriented commodity. And at present, there are 10 multinational companies engaged in the field of cocoa industry and products, beans, chocolates, cocoa butter, powder, and cocoa-based products to other countries. And India earns foreign exchange worth about 849 crores of cocoa bean and its products. And coming to imports, the demand for chocolate industry and confectionaries in India is 30,000 million tons of dry bean per annum. And the current domestic production of cocoa beans is not able to meet the existing demand in India. So, unable to meet the cocoa beans demand in India, we are in a position to import about 1,551 crores of cocoa beans were being imported to India also. Cocoa, as we all know, it is a shade loving plant, and during its seedling period it requires 50% of the shade, and later the shade requirement will be about 40%. And the plant, initially it is being grown as mixed crop with other plantations like spices and rubber, mainly under rain-fed conditions. In Andhra Pradesh, mainly cocoa is planted as an intercrop in coconut, erica nut, and oil palm gardens. So you can see the pictorial representation, coconut and cocoa. Here coconut will be planted 7.5 meter apart, and in between the two rows of coconut, this cocoa plantation can be taken up. And in erica nut and cocoa also, erica nut 2.7 meter spacing. In between two rows of erica nut, the cocoa plants will be accommodated. And in oil palm also, cocoa will be planted in between two rows, and also in between the trees also. Like this, cocoa has a prominent place as a commercial plantation crop and the best suitable intercrop for growing in coconut, erica nut, and oil palm. You can see cocoa as intercrop in coconut, erica nut, and oil palm. Climate and soil. The natural habitat of the cocoa, as earlier told in the introduction, it is habituated to the forest regions in the Amazon, and climatic factors, particularly temperature and rainfall, they are important in encouraging optimum growth. And we all know cocoa is a perennial crop. If we grow cocoa once, it will be there up to 35 to 40 years under favorable conditions and environmental conditions. Altitudes up to 1200 meter mean sea level. Annual rainfall of 1000 mm to 2000 mm is required, and it requires relative humidity of 80% under maximum temperature 35 degree and minimum temperature of 15 degree centigrade is required. And coming to the soil requirements, it is predominantly grown under red lateritic soils, and it thrives well on wide range of soil types with pH ranging from 4.5 to 8, with the optimum pH being 6.5 to 7. So this is about the climatic and soil requirement of cocoa. It requires irrigation and also relative humidity of 80%, maximum 35 and minimum 15 degrees centigrade. But under our conditions, even though in summer the temperatures will be crossing above 40 degrees, even under that conditions also, cocoa is thriving and giving higher yields because of our increased cultivation practices, providing irrigation and all. Next, importance of quality planting material. And we have discussed the importance of cocoa as the intercrop in coconut, cocoa, and erica nut. And it's the spreading cultivation of coconut initiated the production of large number of high yielding hybrids along with clonal materials with the pest and disease resistant and suited to different agroclimatic conditions. And evaluation of germplasm for yield and quality attributes in human tropics help in identifying elite materials which are acclimatized to Indian conditions. And at CPCRA, the work was going on collection of germplasm, screening for yield and resistance to pests and diseases, and the pods collected from best performing cocoa trees were being supplied to the farmers. And so the foremost necessity to get sustainable and profitable perennial crops like cocoa is through supply of good quality planting material. And the good quality planting material should be selected from high yielding and quality mother trees. And we all know cocoa is a highly cross-pollinated crop because it is self-incompatible, and we can't expect the progenies to breed through. And selection and improvement of high yielding cultivars obtained through genetic diversity within the plant. So identification and evaluation of high yielding superior genotypes, it will increase the genetic base of the crop, and the identified trees can be utilized for further breeding program to meet the demand of cocoa beans throughout the world. And next, with the sole aim of encouraging cocoa, intensive area expansion program was taken up in India, combinedly by the DCCD, Directorate of Cashew and Cocoa Development, Central Plantation Crop Research Institute, and state departments with National Horticulture Mission. So the aim is to get sustainable and profitable yields. So to achieve the target of sustainable and profitable yields, supply of quality planting materials is a must. So coming to the cocoa, there are types. First one is Criollo. You can see clearly, see here, Criollo. These are the traditional types, and the fruits are red or purple in color, and there will be anthocyanin pigmentation. Fruit is elongated with a sharp end, and you can see in the picture, the surface of the fruit is rough, and husk is hard. The beans are usually large, but the number of beans will be limited to 30 in number in Criollo, and white or pinkish in color when fresh, and cinnamon colored after 3 days of fermentation. If you go out to see the color after fermentation, it will be cinnamon color. Next one. Criollo trees, they are slow growing, and Criollo is susceptible to pests and diseases. Pure Criollos of Central and South American origin are found only in isolated groups, and these are characterized because of their good flavor as fine cocoa. So Criollo, though the yield is less, there will be good quality fine cocoa comes under Criollo type. And based on their origin and distinct characteristics, Criollo types are classified as Colombian Criollo, Mexican Criollo, Nicaraguan Criollo, Cocoa Real, Pentagona, or Legato types of Criollo. Next, Forastero. Forasteros, they are vigorously growing trees, and the fruits are round and smooth, and the color of the pod is green and yellow when ripe, and the husk is hard, and the beans are flat and dark purple in color. Here the bean number will be more than 30, and they will turn chocolate brown after 6 days of fermentation. So that is the difference between Criollo and Forastero. Here in Forastero, the fruits will be smooth and rounded, whereas in Criollo they will be rough, and in Criollo quality will be more, and compared to Criollo, in Forastero quality will be less. And in Criollo the bean number is limited to 30, and here Forastero type there will be more number of beans. So Forasteros, again, they are grouped according to their geographical origin, like West African cocoas, which have the best flavor suitable for manufacturing of mild chocolates. And Forasteros, they are generally referred to as basic cocoa types. And Forasteros, depending upon their place of origin and the country, they are grouped as Emilinado type, Comum, West African Emilinado, National, Martina or Ceylon, Guyana Wild Emilinado, Amazon populations. These are all grouped under Forasteros. Next is Trinitario. This is the hybrid obtained from natural crosses between Criollo and Forastero. And these are mostly cultivated types. Characteristics of both types. The Trinitario will be possessing the characters of both Triello and Forastero. So it is the hybrid between Triello and Forastero, and has the characteristics of both Triello and Forastero, and they are vigorous and distributed across many countries. Almost 90% of the plantations are Forasteros and Trinitarios. So cocoa breeding objectives. Increase the yield, first one for any crop, first objective will be the increased in yield, lower susceptibility to pests and diseases, greater resilience to climatic events, means droughts, floods, how drought tolerant, we can go for testing of drought tolerance, capacity for increased plant density, the number of plants in the field can be increased, thereby the productivity will increase, and improving flavor, and increase the cocoa butter content, and increase the production stability, reduce management and input costs, minimize interplant competition. So these are the main cocoa breeding objectives, and ideally any good quality planting material means it should be precocious, capable of sustained yields, easy to manage and resistant to major pests and diseases, and it should be highly adaptable to the locality or environment, and it should also satisfy the buyer specifications like bean size, chocolate flavor, etc. Because here mainly in cocoa cultivation, the farmers are cultivating on the basis of buyback. There will be buyback agreement between the Cadbury, that is now Mondelez company, and in Karnataka and Kerala, Campo. These multinational chocolate manufacturing companies, they will have a buyback agreement with the farmers. So the farmers should meet their requirement, their need should be met. So quality of cocoa beans is also very much important. So first one is introduction of the germplasm. In 1969 itself, the germplasm introductions were initiated at CPCRI, Victor, and the collections of cocoa were collected from Malaysia and Nigeria. And it is through ICQC. It means International Cocoa Quarantine Center, for which NPBGR is the nodal agency. Within that one, for all the imports. So in 1969 itself, the introduction of collections were started from Malaysia and Nigeria. It is through International Cocoa Quarantine Center, and about 400 to 500 collections were being maintained at the National Active Germplasm Site for cocoa at CPCRI, Bithal, and also Kerala Agricultural University. So at Central Plantation Crop Research Institute, Bithal, and at Kerala Agricultural University, these germplasm collections were being maintained. And the germplasm collections, they include the clones from Amazon, Ecuador, England, Ghana, Jamaica, Mexico, Nigeria, Peru, and collections from Kallar in Tamil Nadu, Wayanad in Kerala, and the Ghats of Karnataka. So all these germplasm, they are being conserved and evaluated for their compatibility with the other lines, adaptability to the particular environment, and stability for yield. Some cocoa seedlings are clones. Initially, they will be giving high yields and later they will decrease. So we have to see their stability for yields also, and productivity and the quality of the produce in the introduced environment is being tested for all the germplasm lines. And next is breeding through selection. So presence of genetic variability, it offers wide scope for selection of potential cocoa types. As seen earlier, in cocoa, the variability is so high that in a seedling population, about 70% of the yields are obtained from 25% of the trees only. And in any breeding program, yield is the main selection criteria. And the easy approach in yield improvement is to select the plants and subsequently developing them into clones. So here VTLC 1, its origin is in Malaysia and it is cell incompatible but cross compatible, and it will be yielding about 56.3 pods per tree per year, and number of beans per pod are 45, and it will be yielding about 2.51 kg dry bean per tree, and the single dry bean weight is 1.17 gram, and the shelling percentage is 10.5%, fat content will be about 50.3%, and it is heavy bearer as a parental line, and it has the red axil marker. Next is VTLC5. Its origin is in Malaysia, self incompatible and it is cross compatible. It will be yielding about 50 pods per tree per year, and there will be having about 40 beans, and dry bean yield will be about 2.51 kg, and a single dry bean will be weighing about 1.10 gram. Shelling will be about 13% and fat content 52%, and it acts as the best pollen parent. It is high yielder and it is moderately resistant to pod rot. Pod rot is a problem in cocoa, so it is moderately resistant to pod rot. Next is VTLC 30. Its origin is in Nigeria, is self incompatible but it is cross compatible. It will be yielding about 43.2 pods per tree per year, and beans, number of beans per pod are 40, and it will be yielding about 1.54 kg dry bean yield, and single dry bean weight will be about 1.08 gram, and shelling 15.5%, fat content is 46.5%, and it is potential high yielder with bigger bold beans. These are the characteristics of VTLC 30. And next, clonal multiplication. First, clone means an organism or cell or a group of organisms or cells produced asexually from one ancestor or stock from which they are genetically identical. From the genetically identical parent, the clones will be selected and later they will be multiplied. So this clonal selection was also going on at CPCRI and Kerala Agricultural University, depending upon the bean index, bean size and disease resistance. So from ICAR, CPCRI, VTLCS1, VTLCS1, VTLCS2 were released, and VTLC 25, VTLC 15, VTLC 18, VTLC 36, VTLC 13, VTLC 37 and VTLC 17 were identified as heavy bearers with optimal canopy, and 7 clones CCRP 1 to 7 were identified and released through Kerala Agricultural University, and CCRP 1 to 7, they occupied major area in Kerala, Karnataka and Andhra Pradesh. So this is Whittal Cocoa clone 1. This is a Nigerian selection and it is a early heavy bearer, both self and cross compatible. And this is suitable for Erica gardens of Karnataka and cocoa nut gardens of Kerala, Tamil Nadu and Andhra Pradesh. And the pods will be green to yellow in color, and the number of pods per tree are 75, and the pod weight will be about 320 gram, and number of beans will be 36, and dry bean yield per tree will be about 1.33 kg, and yield per hectare will be about 911 kg, and single dry bean weight is about 1.05 gram, and shelling 12% and fat content is about 52.5%. These are the characteristics of Whittal Cocoa clone 1. And next, first criteria for selection of mother trees, either for hybridization or for the multiplication of clones, what are the criteria of the allied mother tree? the forested and interior type of cocoa will be with green or red pods, and then it should be free from major pests and diseases. And the bearing of the elite mother tree should be 80 to 100 pods per tree per year after 12 years of age. And the pod type will be smooth surface with the shallow furrows without prominent constriction at the neck. And the pod size should be medium to large size pods, and the weight should not be less than 350 grams. And next, the pod value means for 1 kg beans, 12 number only, it should be restricted to 12 number. Then it will be the best pod value, and husk thickness should be 1 centimeter only, and the number of beans should be more than 35 per pod. And the bean weight when wet, it should be 3 gram, and when dry, 1 gram and above. So these are the characteristics of elite mother cocoa tree. Seeing these characters, we have to select. First one is yield, then it should be free from pests and diseases, pod type, pod size, pod value, husk thickness and number of beans. Everything is important. And the dry bean weight should be 1 gram and more. Next, you can see here harvesting of cocoa is also important, because this is cauliflower. The flowers will be like cushion, and the fruits also will be like that only. And when we are harvesting the pod with the hands, it may disturb the side by flower and pod. So harvesting using sickle or secateur like that should be followed. And also when we are collecting the beans for the purpose of raising seedlings, middle seed should be collected. Next, breeding through hybridization. Most commonly adopted method is developing or crossing between two distinct genotypes and selecting, which will be based on heterosis and hybrid vigor. So when we are talking about hybridization, first we have to know in brief about the floral biology. Here we have already discussed that cocoa is a cross-pollinated crop, and it reproduces sexually because it has a lot of variation in its progeny. And if you observe here, you can see the flowers are in cushion. They are small, hermaphrodite, and they will be appearing in large numbers as cushion on the shoot when the tree attains 2 to 3 years age. When the tree attains 2 to 3 years of age, small hermaphrodite flowers will appear as cushions, and this flowering behavior is called as cauliflorous or truncate. And the flowers will be about 15 mm in diameter, borne on long pedicels. They will be having 5 presepals, 5 prepetals, 10 stamens, and the ovary will be having 5 united carpels. And the inflorescence primordia will be arising from old leaf axils, and it takes about 30 days from initiation for the bud to emerge through the bark and mature. And cocoa, it produces a large number of flowers, about 10,000 flowers, but only 1 to 5% of the flowers, they get successfully pollinated to produce a pod. So this is about the flowering behavior, and there is incompatible mechanism in cocoa. The self-incompatibility in cocoa was first reported in 1932. And what is self-incompatibility? Means the pollen, when it reaches stigma of the same plant, it cannot get fertilized. And here, particularly in cocoa, gametophytic self-incompatibility was observed. So many of the cocoa types, they are self-incompatible, but they are cross-compatible. So there will be a chance for artificial pollination. And the degree of incompatibility will be varying between different types. And self-compatible genotypes are found in lower Amazon basin, Criollo and Trinitario, whereas the upper Amazon forasteros are generally self incompatible. And the Amazon cultivars, they are self incompatible but are compatible. And then Trinitario cultivars, they have a high proportion of self incompatible trees which will not cross with other self incompatible, but they require pollen from self compatible trees for pollination. So method of hand pollination. So in artificial pollination, the flower, the whitish color of the flower and swollen appearance, you can see the flower bud which will open the following day will be identified by its whitish color and swollen appearance. And the bud will be covered with the plastic tube, and that will be sealed to the bark using materials like plasticine. So first we'll select the flower bud, and then the flower bud will be covered with the hood of plastic pipe. And next, the tube will be covered with muslin cloth at the top, and it will be kept in place without movement with the help of a rubber band. Why we will do this? Because it will ensure circulation of air and exclusion of insects. So that is the main reason. And the open flowers, they will be collected from the desired male parent, and the stamens are carefully taken out by pushing, and one entire anther with a part of the filament will be deposited on the stigma, and the style will be surrounded by a ring of stem nodes, and if these stem nodes are long, they can be removed for easy access to the style, because then perfect pollination and later fertilization will occur. And as usual in the hybridization method, here emasculation is not necessary because incompatible nature. So, and for selfing, hand pollination will be done. And then the pollinated flowers will be fixed using thin foil pieces in the cushion using ball pins, and the hoods will be removed 24 hours after pollination, and in 3 to 5 days fertilization will be confirmed by the visual swelling of the ovary. We can clearly see the visual swelling of the ovary. And in order to prevent undue shedding and wilting of fruits from hand pollination, it is usual to remove all the developing fruits on the tree produced by open pollination. Unless we remove the fruits produced by open pollination, we can't differentiate which is the hybridized fruit and which is the normal fruit. Next, so the developing parts, they will be covered with a wire mesh because to protect them from mammalian pests. The mammalian pests may be rodents or squirrels like that. Then complete protection will be given. And if we operate a good pollinator, he will be doing about the 300 pollinations per day, and which may result in 150 pods. And if the flowers are unpollinated, they will abscess within 24 hours. And a fully grown cocoa tree will be producing 10,000 flowers, and which perhaps about 50 to 100 flowers only will develop into fruits. And next, natural pollination. Natural pollination in cocoa is mainly through midges. The female flying midges are the pollinating agents in cocoa, and they belong to the genus Forsythomia. And the sucking pest thrips, aphids, they also contribute to the pollination, but to a limited extent. And the pollen dispersal will be there up to 40 meters. So most pollination occurs in the morning, and hence artificial pollination should be done before midday during fine weather. So these are the Whittell cocoa hybrid selections which are being maintained at Whittell and also at the horticulture institution Ambajipeta. And this Whittell cocoa hybrid. One, the parents are 156 into 267, both are Malaysian types. It will vigorous, early, heavy bearer, and they are suitable for coconut and coconut gardens. The pods will be green to yellow in color, and there will be 50 pods, and the pod weight will be 350 gram, and number of beans are 42, and dry bean yield is about 1.48 kg, and 1000 kg per hectare yield will be obtained, and single dry bean weight is about 1 gram, shelling is 13%, and fat content is 53.6%. Next, Whittle Cocoa Hybrid 2. It is a cross between the parents ICS6 and SCS6. Both are from Malaysia and similar in characters with that of Whittle Cocoa Hybrid 1. But here, the number of pods have increased. 70 pods will be getting, and pod weight also is more, about 350 gram. And dry bean yield is 1.15 kg. But yield per hectare is only 800 kg. And the single dry bean weight is 1.15 gram. And shelling is 11%. And fat content is about 54%. Whittle Cocoa Hybrid 2. And then Whittle Cocoa Hybrid 3. This is the cross between 267 into NC29/66. This is Malaysian, the cross between Malaysian and Nigerian type. And all other characters are similar. Coming to the pods per tree, there are 45 pods per tree per year, and pod weight is very large, 430 gram, and number of beans 43, and dry bean yield per tree per year is 1.45 kg, and it will be giving an yield of 993 kg per hectare, and single dry bean weight is about 1.07 gram, and with the shelling 13% and fat content of 52%. Next is Whittle Cocoa Hybrid 4. Here the parents are 267 into NC42/94. The cross between Malaysian and Nigerian type, early heavy bearer. And here the advantage with Whittle Cocoa Hybrid 4 is it is suitable for water limited conditions, means drought conditions. It can be, the trials were conducted in drought prone areas of Karnataka. And this is suitable for growing in coconut gardens of Karnataka, Kerala, Tamil Nadu, Andhra, Maharashtra, and Goa. The pods are red to orange in color, and the pods per tree per year are 40, and pod weight is 425 gram. Number of beans are 43, and dry bean yield per tree per year is 1.25 kg, and yield per hectare is 856 kg. And single dry bean weight is about 1.01 gram. So, we have already discussed about the floral behavior of cocoa and incompatibility mechanism in cocoa. So, utilizing this incompatibility mechanism, instead of going for artificial pollination, we can allow natural cross-pollination by establishment of seed gardens or clonal orchards. So, the advantage of maintaining this clonal garden or seed garden is to produce seeds of known parentage, and also we can know the yield. And the compatibility reactions shown by cocoa varieties are different to each other, and self-incompatible varieties will be selected. And the hybrid will be collected from this self-incompatible female parent. So this is biclonal orchard. Biclonal orchard means we will be taking two varieties, for example I-14 and I-56. Here what is this means, one both are self-incompatible. The two varieties taken for the purpose of biclonal orchard, they will be self-incompatible but cross-compatible with each other. Okay, the pollen does not fertilize the stigma of the same plant, but it will fertilize the other plant. So instead of taking all the risk and going for artificial pollination, we can go for natural pollination by going for biclonal orchards. And the similar example with the ICS6 and SCS6, we can maintain two self-incompatible varieties, but they should be cross-compatible and the hybrids can be selected. So the naturally the obtained food will be hybrid only. So these are the advantages of maintaining biclonal orchard. And both the hybrids, whether on parent one or parent two, they will be similar in character unless there are some maternal effects, because the genotype is similar. Here only maternal effects may change. The hybrid will be similar. So this is one way of allowing the natural cross-pollination between the varieties, that is biclonal orchids. And similar is the way with the polyclonal orchids. Polyclonal orchids, the mechanism is also similar to biclonal orchids, but in polyclonal orchids we'll be getting mixtures, means different hybrids will be getting. Here for example, four parents were taken and they are self incompatible, but they are cross compatible with each other. So we'll be getting a mixture of hybrids, but as we know their parentage, the hybrid will be high performing. So these are the advantages. So by maintaining biclonal orchards and polyclonal orchards, we could be able to supply the seed for area expansion programs. And the biclonal orchards and polyclonal orchards are being maintained at CPCRI and also at Kerala Agricultural University. For example, from 1 acre of the gardens, we can able to give plants sufficient to 400 acres in 4th year and to about 1200 acres in 11th year. So the problem of quality planting material or supply of planting material will be solved. In polyclonal garden, we have to take care that one male parent will be there for every 5 female parent trees, and the seed will be collected from the self-incompatible parent. So as the parent is self-incompatible and it will be cross-compatible, and there will be assurance for us of getting hybrid only. So this is in detail about the biclonal and polyclonal orchards. So after doing all the breeding objectives, we'll be getting the pods. And the cocoa pods, they take 150 to 170 days from pollination to attend the harvesting stage. And we can clearly know the change of color from green to yellow means they are mature. And they remain without damage up to a maximum of 1 month. And we should see the rodents does not attack. If they are ripe, the rodents will damage. And the mature pods will be available during May month under Karnataka conditions and also under AP conditions. As shown in the previous slide, the harvesting of the pods should be done with the sharp knife or secateur only, because cocoa is cauliflorous in nature. You should never pick the pods with hand. And the harvested seed pods can be stored in shade up to 1 week. But once if you open the pod, the seed should be kept for germination immediately, because viviparous nature of the cocoa seed. Germination should be kept immediately. So seed standards, viability and storage. So well matured seed pods, they can be broken by heating against the hard surface or using wooden mallet. Metals should not be used because it will be used for consumable produce for the manufacturing of chocolate, and they will extract the seeds. And the seed should be bold, large, and it should weigh around 3 grams when wet, and when dry it will be 1 gram. And seeds in cocoa are rich in strength. As we have already discussed, they have no dormancy period. So immediately after extracting, they should be sown in the nursery. And germination will start in about a week, and it will be continued for about another week. And when the seeds are taken from the ripe fruit, the seed will be surrounded by mucilaginous pulp. It will be containing a germination inhibitor. So to speed up the germination, we have to remove the pulp. The testa is usually called the skin, and when dry it is called a shell, and a trained person can fill 200 seeds per hour. Then we can rub the beans over dry sand, and then to remove the mucilage, and then if sown with mucilage, insects will be attracted. So seed dressing can be done with insecticides or with fungicides like carbendazim. They can be used at the rate of 2 gram per kg of seed under adverse situations. Under normal conditions, there is no requirement for insecticide and fungicides. And so when we are sowing in the polybags, the seed should be kept horizontally or vertically with the hilum down, and it should be covered with sand. And we should not push the seeds deeply into the potting mixture, because lack of air may affect the seed germination, as it is epigeal. And when the initial stage of germination is called as soldier phase, and about 95% germination will be usually observed in cocoa. And the cocoa seeds can be kept for germination at any time of the year, provided with proper irrigation facilities. And the sowing should be completed before the onset of monsoon. Otherwise, in heavy downfall areas, the showers may affect the germination. And the seedlings which are sown in May will be ready for planting in September to October. So next, after obtaining the seedlings, establishment of nursery. For establishment of nursery, we have to see the suitable climate and soil, as we have discussed earlier. And next is water source. And if you want to start a nursery, first thing is perennial source of water should be there for maintenance of mother trees or for the purpose of giving irrigation to seedlings. And regular irrigation should be given to the seedlings, and a sprinkler and hose pipes can be used during later stages. So depending upon the season, the irrigation should be given without fail. And nursery structures, because we have already discussed earlier, cocoa is a shade loving plant. The young seedlings also should be located in a shaded area. So to provide shade, 50% shade net or 75% shade net can be used. And if you go for 50,000 bag of seedlings, you can erect the shade net. And next, above all, as we know, skilled manpower is required either for the purpose of selection or hybridization, pollination, and the collection of scion sticks, grafting, budding, and everything. Skilled manpower is highly essential for the production of quality planting material. And also nursery assistant or skill supporting staff will be needed, because for the removal of a polythene pouch after graft set, polythene tied over graft joint at correct time, and maintenance of the nursery, and for identifying and lifting good seedlings, we have to require supporting staff, and skilled persons are required. And the management, how to maintain a nursery, because cocoa is a perennial crop, and also for the maintenance of seeds and seedlings, records should be maintained. In the records, clearly it should be indicated the name of the variety, date of sowing, number of seeds sown, seed bed number, and seed pod harvest, because it becomes easy for the maintenance of progeny detail or pedigree details, and everything will be clear for the development of the variety. And a signboard can be placed in front of each bed indicating the name of variety and also the date of sowing, so that there will be no confusion. And the seeds of the clones, they begin germination within 10 to 15 days, whereas the seeds of the hybrids, they come to germination early, 7 to 10 days after sowing. So depending upon the days to germination, we can differentiate whether they are the seeds of clones or seeds of hybrids. And after seeing for 15 days, if the seeds do not germinate, those can be removed from the nursery. And Above all, the important thing is maintenance of proper drainage during the rainy season, because there will be stagnation of water and rotting of seedlings will occur. So we should see the maintenance of proper drainage. And above all, the nursery should be kept free of weeds to allow good growth of the seedlings. Next, polybag nursery. And to get better root and shoot growth, and to make the planting and transportation easier, polythene bags are the best. And polybags are usually cheaper and durable. And black polybags of 6 by 9 inches size and 250 gauge thickness are suited for raising cocoa nursery. And the potting mixture, soil, sand and farmed manure will be in the ratio of 2:1:1. And soil solarization by sun drying and covering of the potting mixture with black sheet during summer months will enhance the seedling vigor and health. And the topsoil and sand should be sieved before filling, because for proper penetration of the root. And organic manures like soil compost, vermicompost, bean shells, etc. can be used instead of farmed manure. And biopriming of the potting mixture can also be done with the microbial cultures like Pseudomonas, there because they will enhance the growth and the health of the seedlings. And if we want to keep the seedlings in the nursery for longer period, big poly bags of 30 cm length and 20 cm width can be selected. And the poly bags can be arranged in rows, leaving the space between them, because it will provide easy monitoring. And then shade nets can be provided. If the shade nets are not available, and covering by thatches, anything organic manure or any readily available cheaper material can be used. Here, the soldier phase of germination and the stages of seedling growth. Then, which way to propagation. Here all we have discussed about the seed method, germplasm, collection, selection, hybridization, clonal propagation. And now we stay to propagation. Grafting and budding are being followed in cocoa. As the seedlings, they show wider genetic variability because of self-incompatible nature. So to get true to type, vegetative propagation is the one to be followed. And the advantage of vegetative propagation is we can identify high yielding clones, and the high yielding clones can be produced in large quantities, and also the grafts, they are early bearing in nature. And softwood method of grafting was standardized at CPCRI Bittel with 85% success rate. And first thing in grafting, we all know selection of stock and selection of scion, these are all important. And 3 to 4 months old seedlings raised in polybag, they can be used as rootstock. And elite mother tree, which we have identified from that tree, scion stick of 12 to 15 centimeter length with 2 to 3 buds should be selected. And if we want a seedling architecture and lesser pruning, we have to take the scion sticks from chupans. And if it is for breeding works and for large scale commercial production, we should take from fan branches. So rootstock stem and scion stick should be of same thickness and same physiological age. So just in brief about the structure, cocoa tree, you can clearly see in the picture. You can see the trunk, flowers on the trunk, fruits on the trunk, the pods, different parts of the cocoa tree. You just concentrate on the sucker or chupan and the fan branches. Here, the place at the joint where the first branch occurs is called as jarket in cocoa. This is the difference for sucker and fan branch. Just to show the difference between sucker and fan branch, I am explaining you all this thing. Here, the fan branches, they grow horizontal to the ground, whereas chupans, they are showing vertical growth. you can see fan branches are horizontal and chupons are vertical in growth, and the arrangement of leaves is a spiral in chupon, and it is like a spiral in chupon, and chupons they have swelling at the origin of the petiole. So depending upon our purpose, we have to select the cyan stick either from the sucker or either from the fan branch. So grafting methods, we are all aware. So first we'll take the rootstock and we'll be giving horizontal cut in the upper portion of the rootstock with a grafting knife, and we'll be making a vertical slit of 2 to 3 centimeters down on the decapitated rootstock. Next, we'll be giving V-shaped slanting cut of 2 to 3 centimeter length to the defoliated cyan stick, and we'll insert the cyan into the stalk. So this is wedge grafting, and then we will tie the graft joint tightly with the polythene strip, and then we'll be covering with the polythene pouch, and this pouch will be removed after 15 to 20 days, and perfect graft joint will occur in 1 month. We'll remove the polythene sheet after 2 months, and we'll be getting successful graft ready within 5 months after planting. So this is about grafting in cocoa. So what is the care to be taken? The emerging shoots from the rootstocks should be removed. If the emerging shoots from the rootstocks are not removed, later we'll be confused whether the rootstock is growing or cyan is growing. This is the first point to be remembered in grafting. The emerging shoots from the rootstock should be removed. And October to December season will be the best for grafting, because suitable sunlight will be there, temperatures will be medium. In summer, if you go for grafting, due to high temperatures, they may dry up. In those odd conditions also, we can go for grafting, provided with sufficient irrigation, and the graft will start yielding from the second year onwards. The what is the advantage with grafting? We can easily produce the pest and disease resistant clones. And other advantages, unpredictable plants can be rejuvenated. Similar with the mango here, top working can be done. If you remove the growing shoot and if you do top working here, cocoa, the old cocoa gardens can be rejuvenated using top working. And if you want to go for conservation of multiple varieties on a single tree, similar to mango, you can also go for grafting in cocoa. So when budded or grafted, we have to go. Use of single clone may not yield because self-incompatibility occurs in cocoa. So you should go for 2 or more clones for planting. And also, budwood can be stored by dipping in benzyl chloride and all that, so that the storage life of the budwood will increase. So selection of seedlings and transplanting. Only vigorous seedlings will be used based on height and girth. So when the seedlings are grown under heavy shade before transplanting, we have to subject them to the hardening. And so before lifting of the seedlings, watering of the beds should be done to avoid the breakage of roots. And also, if the nursery was raised in polythene bags, the polythene cover should be removed before planting, and it should be planted along with the ball of earth into the pit. And the seedling or graft or budded plant should be planted in the center of the pit and not too deep. So here, while planting, grafts, polythene strip tied over the graft joint should be removed, and the planting material may be 4 to 6 months old one, and avoid planting seedlings with twisted or damaged ones. And for long distance transportation, in the poly bags, we can use coir compost instead of soil or sand, because if you use coir peat compost, they will be lighter in weight and the transportation becomes easier. So what was the strategy to be followed for disease tracks? So mainly on diseases and the insects, Phytophthora quadrat is seen in cocoa, and also thrips, millibugs and three mosquito bugs will be there. So when we are going, the pods, the damaged pods should be avoided, and pods eaten or damaged by rats and squirrels also should not be taken. And the nursery shouldn't be raised in areas susceptible to vascular streak dieback disease. This disease is common in Kerala and Karnataka, so we should avoid the areas where it is prevalent. Vascular streak dieback disease prevalent areas are to be avoided for growing nursery. And poly greenhouses can be utilized for screening, protection and hardening of the seedlings. And nursery diseases. While growing nursery, we should take care about the seedling dieback, seedling blight, and in particularly rainy season, the precautions should be taken to avoid the pod rot. And in nursery also, we can go for spraying of Blightax, and measures should be taken. And if proper care is not taken, the disease, it will spread to the entire stem, and it causes wilting, defoliation, and ultimately the death of the seedlings. And so removal and destruction of infected seedlings from nursery is very important to check the secondary spread of the disease. And the disease instance can be reduced if proper drainage facilities are provided with, if the nursery is provided with proper drainage facilities. And we can drench the seedlings with Bordax mixture or carbendazim before the onset of monsoon to control seedling dieback. Here clearly we can see the seedling dieback symptoms in the polybag. And regarding pest, this is a caterpillar attack, caterpillar damage we can see. And also the sucking pests, they will be infecting the cocoa seedlings. Here you can see the difference between the tree raised from seedling and the tree from graft. By seeing the tree canopy and structure, we can identify whether it is grown from seedling or from graft. And then cocoa seedling standards. The age of the seedling should be 5 to 6 months. And height should be 40 to 50 centimeter, and girth of the seedling 3.5 to 4 centimeter, and 5 to 6 pairs of leaves should be there, and the growth should be straight from the middle of the polybag without jarketing, and foliage should be green, healthy, without crinkling or nutrient deficiency, and middle leaves of 15 centimeter length should be there, and taproot should be spreading without netting, and the potting mixture will potting mixture containing soil, sand and farmyard manure in the ratio of 2:1 in 6x9 inches polybag should be there, and precautions from nursery diseases and pests should be taken. So these are the cocoa seedling standards, and next are the cocoa graft standards, and it should be a polybag nursery, and age of the rootstock should be 4 to 5 months, and height of the rootstock is 50 centimeter and 3.5 centimeter girth with 7 pairs of leaves, and the scion size thickness should be same as rootstock, and the softwood length should be 12 to 15 centimeter with the 2 to 3 buds and defoliated. And the graft union should be 20 centimeter above the soil, 2 centimeter thickness, and should be covered with polythene pouch. And the grafted plant without jarketing, it should be there, height of 60 and 7 pairs of healthy leaves, and the taproot should be well spread. And precautions, we should remove the polythene pouch after 15 to 20 days of grafting. So coming to the conclusion, quality planting material in perennial crops like cocoa, it is very important as we discussed for getting higher yields, to increase the productivity, and for increasing the overall economic conditions of the farmers. And as the graduates of horticulture and agriculture, you require this for your student readiness program, because you can plan where you can invest. You can learn the techniques. You will be well acquainted in ELP, and you can plan to raise the quality planting material in cocoa. Thank you.
The participants, they can ask questions now. If you have any doubt, you can unmute yourself and you can ask. Or else you can also post in the chat box.
Any questions?
Ravi, any questions in the chat box?
I think no questions, madam. In YouTube also.
Okay.
So I will conclude.
Yes. Ravi, any questions in the chat box?
I think no questions, madam. In YouTube also. I will conclude.
Yes. Any questions in the chat box?
Why it is repeatedly? So thank you, Dr. Padma, for addressing the participants and explaining about production of quality planting material in cocoa, which is an important intercrop in coconut, covering the importance of crop, types of cocoa, and how to produce quality planting material in cocoa, how to establish and manage a nursery, all those things you have covered very nicely. So thank you once again, Dr. Padma, for delivering a very useful lecture to the participants. The participants, please, the feedback link is provided in the chat box and you can fill that and submit. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ravi Sigetha.